Just north of Central Park and the famous Manhattan skyline sits an inner city community, Harlem. And while Harlem has its poverty and its problems, there are other tales on this side of town. Stories of success. Stories of children who through the years have grown up to become leaders in business, government, and entertainment. Let us take you back in time for a story about one of Harlem's heroes. He was a boxer, a puncher, a gladiator, a charmer outside the ring. Inside, he is still considered, pound for pound, the greatest fighter who ever lived. Today, we'll take a look back and remember the original Sugar Ray, Sugar Ray Robinson. From the Salem United Methodist Church on 129th Street and 7th Avenue, Adam Clayton Powell Jr. Boulevard in Harlem. Hello everyone, I'm James Brown and welcome to our show. What does a story about a tough customer in a rough sport have to do with a house of worship? Well, this is where Sugar Ray Robinson got his start. No, not fighting during Sunday services, but down below. In the basement was the headquarters of the Salem Crescent Boxing Club. The club is gone now, and only a basketball court remains. But this is where Sugar Ray Robinson worked on developing and honing his skills. And it was 50 years ago that Ray Robinson emerged from the gym and into the limelight for the first time, winning the prestigious New York Golden Gloves.
Although only 19, Robinson appears to have a boxing finesse far beyond his years. A pulverizing right crashes off Valentine's jaw.
We know him as Sugar Ray Robinson, but he was born Walker Smith Jr. in Detroit. At age 11, his mother moved the family to New York, eventually settling in Harlem during the Depression.
Growing up, he was just an ordinary child. You know, a prankness. He was mischievous. He did a lot of devilish things.
A pastor guided him into the church gym, but when it came time to fight amateur bouts, he was underage. So Walker Smith Jr. assumed another fighter's name and identity.
A friend of mine, whose name was Ray Robinson, I borrowed his birth certificate. And I meant to give him back his name, but he said I had to steal it.
The new Ray Robinson never looked back. He picked up a nickname when a sports writer said to his trainer, "You have a sweet fighter there." The trainer responded, "Sweet as sugar." Others might be quicker or hit harder, but no one put it together so well so often. Sugar Ray himself once said, "You have to look twice to see me once."
I think pound for pound, he was the greatest of ever one except in the ring.
Don't forget, the guy had over 200 fights. He fought for 25 years. He knew everything. He's a masterful boxer, terrific puncher, and he was just a great, great competitor.
Ray's style in the ring was to knock you out as soon as possible.
I guess he had a panache. You know, he could do it all. He could box, he could slug, he could defend himself. I once saw him knock out a guy moving backward. He was moving backward, not the guy. And knocked him out with a left hook, cold conked him.
Robinson was one of four magnificent men whose accomplishments spanned four decades and whose triumphs meant so much to the black community.
Certainly another pleasure on my part to present to you, Ray Robinson, this Achievement Award.
In those days when Ray was victorious as often as he was, there would be an impromptu gathering of folks and a motorcade procession would begin with Ray leading. And they would ride for blocks going up 7th Avenue and the horns tooting. Ray was a Harlem and Harlem was Ray.
Ray's appeal was also universal. He was a showman, a ham, a flashy dresser, and a soft touch who looked good at whatever he did and wherever he went. Although the word entourage was not coined just for him, Robinson's followers certainly fit the definition.
When he went to Europe for the first time, he took along a hairdresser, a valet, a golf pro.
He wanted to be a champion. It was important for him to be a champion. It was important for him to be liked. And I imagine that's why so many people were around him.
And what they liked to be around most was his pink Cadillac.
There were days when Ray would get in his pink Cadillac and just sit in it and people would just want to touch it. There was some magic to his charisma.
Basically a kid at heart, you'd think Sugar Ray would be happy to fight for free. But Ray was smarter than that, as was discovered in 1957 on the Person to Person show with Edward R. Murrow.
You give me the impression that you rather enjoy your work, is that right?
No, just the opposite, Ed. I've never enjoyed boxing. It's just a business with me, and I know I've never enjoyed it.
It can be a brutal business. The night after dreaming it would happen, Sugar Ray Robinson killed Jimmy Doyle in the ring. It took Robinson 75 pro bouts before he won the welterweight title and later beat Jake LaMotta for the middleweight crown. His only knockout was at the hands of Joey Maxim in 104-degree heat. Every fighter alive, back then and even today, knows about Sugar Ray Robinson.
I think boxing was always some people don't like it and some people do like it. And I guess he got more people to like it, really.
A great fighter is somebody that could always come back from the brink of destruction, and him and having over 202 fights, at least 80 or 90 of those fights, he's at the brink of destruction, almost losing, and coming back to win. I mean, that shows the character.
After losing to Joey Maxim, Ray retired to go on tour as a tap dancer. After a 22-month layoff, Sugar Ray returned to boxing out of love for the sport as well as a need for money. But he was now almost 34 years old and not the same. Still, he went on, beating Bobo Olsen to regain his middleweight crown, losing it to Gene Fulmer, and then coming back to reclaim it from him. He lost it to Carmen Basilio. Their rematch was anxiously awaited by the media.
Carmen, in all the excitement after the weigh-in, just one question. I've polled 10 sports writers from around the nation here, and 9 of them picked Sugar Ray to win by a knockout tonight. What's your answer to that?
9 of them are wrong.
Thank you, Carmen.
Thank you.
9 of them were right. He beat Basilio that night in 1958, but lost the crown again in 1960.
I would like to end this career with a great climax, if I possibly can. If I can regain the middleweight championship for the 6th time, I most certainly would then say it's been a very wonderful career, and thank God and all the wonderful people who've prayed for my success.
Sugar Ray never won that title again. At the age of 44, he was fighting kids in their 20s for $500 purses. In December 1965, Sugar Ray Robinson retired. They held a night in his honor at Madison Square Garden in the same ring where a quarter century earlier, he got started on his fabulous career.
He was the best fighter I ever saw. And I've been looking at fighters for 55 years.
He'd have a picnic today with what's around, including Tommy Hearns and Sugar Ray Leonard. They wouldn't be strong enough for him.
Of all the fighters, I put him up there on Mount Olympus. With all due respect to a great guy like Joe Louis, Rocky Marciano, Tony Canzoneri, Willie Pep, Sandy Sadler, so many greats, Muhammad Ali. They come here, Ray Robinson's up there, up on Mount Olympus by himself. Just an unusually great, great fighter.
He was a champion indeed. And in no fight was this more evident than the St. Valentine's Day Massacre. Sugar Ray Robinson versus Jake LaMotta. Now we'll show you some selected rounds from the original television broadcast back in 1951 when we continue.
15 round world middleweight championship bout between the champion Jake LaMotta and the challenger Sugar Ray Robinson.
I want you to break clean. No rapid punching, no kidney punches. Be careful of your low punches, they may cost you a round.
Well, who better to watch the Sugar Ray Robinson-Jake LaMotta fight with than CBS Sports boxing analyst and champion trainer Gil Clancy. And Gil, so much talk about this great fighter, but what made Sugar Ray so special to you?
There's only one word to describe Sugar Ray Robinson, and that's class.
Now, this fight matched then welterweight champion Sugar Ray against middleweight champ Jake LaMotta. What about LaMotta?
LaMotta was probably the most underrated middleweight of all time. Strong guy, he could box and he could punch. Unfortunately, he came along at the same time as the great Sugar Ray Robinson.
Now, these two had fought 5 times before, with LaMotta winning only once. What were your thoughts going into the 6th and final bout?
Jake was a little bit over the hill going into this fight, and I thought that Ray Robinson, with his speed, would be able to pick him apart.
All right, now, the fight you're about to see was broadcast live on February 14th, 1951, to the largest TV audience ever at that time. We're going to pick up the action in the fourth round. The site was Chicago Stadium, and sportscaster Ted Husing called the bout.
The bell for round number four. Sugar Ray Robinson in the white. The middleweight champion, Jake LaMotta, in the black trunks. Slightest trickle of blood appears just inside LaMotta's right nostril. Robinson was a fury then, looking for the KO. Two minutes to go, that straight right rocked LaMotta. Robinson is also bleeding slightly from both nostrils. To go, round number four. And now Robinson's beginning to use combinations of punches, including the bolo, as well as the jabs and the hooks. LaMotta keeps boring in. That's the best blow LaMotta has scored tonight. Half a minute to go, fourth round. There's the bell ending round number four, an exhibition of the aggressor and on occasions the counterpuncher. The fifth round of a 15-round world championship fight for the middleweight title here in Chicago, and there they go. Both boys have attending positions in their corners tonight with honorary second cards. Two minutes to go of round number five. Thank you. fought blood from Robinson's nostril. The left with the right cross. 1 minute to go, round number five. Half a minute to go of the fifth round. One half a minute to go. The bell ending round number five. Certainly LaMotta's best round so far. They're up on their feet. There's the bell. No knockdowns so far in the fight. And that great action by LaMotta, he couldn't score the big one. A slowly tiring Ray Robinson wasn't punching cleanly when he came out of it, missing. Robinson's left hook was low. He was warned by referee Frankie Sikora. One minute to go of round 11. I guess you saw those four blows all cleanly. Robinson was hurting LaMotta. He's hurting him now. Half a minute to go of the 11th round. Robinson set him up with those body blows. Damaged his nose. He has LaMotta on Queer Street holding on. There's the bell, ending round number 11. Well, certainly that was one of the most damaging evidences of punching that you have seen in recent years. Well, hold on to your hats, this may be it. Boy, these are all of Ray Robinson's Sunday punches. Round the ringside, the greatest sports writers in the world. Of course, the greatest names are here from the theater, civic life, sports. Headed, of course, by the president of the International Boxing Club, James D. Norris. 2 minutes to go of the 12th round. LaMotta's left eye is beginning to close. The punches rock him. He's very weary. He winces when he's hit now. The crowd senses the kill. LaMotta is completely on Queer Street. He's fighting now. Cautiously. And rockily. He is badly cut as far as punching is concerned. Around his right eye. 1 minute to go, 12th round. Robinson is merciless, keeps looking at the clock. No man can endure this pummeling. Row after row after row from the ring, the crowd is standing and cheering. LaMotta is just a catcher with a half a minute to go, mouth wide open, left eye bleeding. The round is almost over. There's the bell ending the 12th round. The huzzas of the crowd, listen to them. Round number 13, the hard luck number. LaMotta's left eye is closing gradually. 2 minutes to go, round 13. LaMotta at this moment, a tired battler, a chopping block. Robinson trying to KO him. For 8 rounds, LaMotta gave better than he took. And then Robinson unleashed all of his best guns for the last 4 rounds. These are clean whistling shots, lefts and rights. How he can survive them, nobody knows. Head shake at the ringside. The fight is going to be stopped on the signal from the chairman of the Illinois Athletic Commission, Joe Kleiner, to Frankie Sikora. The fight was stopped in the 13th round with our scorecard showing that Ray Robinson was ahead 63 points to 57. And in the 13th round, the hard luck round, the championship of the world has changed hands.
Now, the time of that TKO was 2:04 of the 13th round. And, Gil, there was so much great action in that fight, but what do you remember most about it?
I remember the amazing, blazing combinations that Sugar Ray Robinson threw, but it was more amazing that Jake LaMotta could absorb all this punishment before he was finally stopped.
All right, and after the fight, Ray Robinson spoke to Ted Husing and the television audience.
I'd like to ask you one question before you go, Ray. When did you know that you had him? Because you were fighting pretty evenly for 8 rounds.
Well, that's the way we planned the fight. We figured LaMotta would be strong as he was first part of the fight, and the last part of the fight he would weaken. We figured to box along the first part of the fight and wait till he showed signs of weakening, which he did.
I see.
And in those late rounds, after the eighth, he showed signs, and my manager told me to start throwing, open up heavier punches.
Well, Ray, my congratulations to you. You're a wonderful champion. As a welterweight, I hope that you're the greatest the middleweight division ever knew.
As we look at it one more time, 38 years after the St. Valentine's Day massacre, Jake LaMotta recalled what it was like.
The referee stopped the fight the 13th round while I was still on my feet with Robinson pounding me up against the ropes. If the referee held up another 30 seconds, Robinson would have collapsed from hitting me.
Coming up, you'll see some of Sugar Ray's knockout power and how those outside the ring remember him.
Well, I tell you, what comes to mind is a great fighting machine.
Was Sugar Ray the greatest? He certainly gets Muhammad Ali's vote. A young Cassius Clay looked up to Robinson.
His mother brought him around. He'd come by the training camps and the Durant gyms whenever we were training and sit and watch. And he was a great, he learned very fast.
Fast enough to beat Sonny Liston. In fact, the then Cassius Clay had Sugar Ray with him for the Liston fight.
I say I'm the greatest heavyweight of all times, but pound for pound, I still say Sugar Ray Robinson was the greatest of all times.
Even before Ali's time, Ray wasn't afraid to play to the camera or to the crowd.
I'd never known him till he fought Villemain in Philadelphia at the stadium. There were 30,000 people, and I was sitting in the third row press when he came into the ring, and the second said, "That's Bob Hope down there." And he looked down and he said, "When are we going to play golf, you know? With 30, he's fighting for the championship." And after the third round, he treated Villemain like he was a sparring partner, just so sensational. And after the third round, he looked at me again, going back to his corner, and said, "Hey, let's play, let's play." And of course, he walked him. Outside of that, he was a very, very wonderful man.
Robinson did have time for fun, but there was also a serious side to the man. After Sugar Ray retired from boxing, he and his wife moved to Los Angeles, where they helped set up the Sugar Ray Robinson Foundation to assist underprivileged children.
I got involved in helping children, like I'm doing now. That's been my life, and I'm sure it will be until the day I die. I love children, and I love trying to help them.
He says to me, "Honey, this is the greatest fight of my life, fighting for children and with the children."
Publicizing his cause was very important to Ray.
What's the name of that organization that you're interested in?
Sugar Ray Youth Foundation.
There you go.
Gently, gently.
And one who benefited from the foundation recalled his influence.
He told me, he said, "You know you're a fast runner." I said, "Well, thank you." I was very shy. And he said, "No, keep your head up. Don't look down. You're a great person." And I said, "Well, thank you." I said, "Well, not as great as you." And he made the comment that one day you will be and you will see.
Sugar Ray Robinson was an inspiration indeed. But Gil, I've got to ask you, what would you do if one of your fighters was clowning around with somebody in the audience like Ray Robinson was with Bob Hope?
Boxing is a sport that requires complete concentration. And if one of my guys was trying to communicate with somebody in the audience, I'd throw him on the stool and he'd hear from me.
All right, well, the fight we're about to take a look at is the final round of Sugar Ray Robinson versus Rocky Graziano back in 1952. Gil, size up Graziano.
Graziano was a dangerous right-hand puncher. That's just about it with him. Could get anybody out if he hit him with a right hand, but he didn't figure to hit the great Sugar Ray.
This fight also took place in Chicago Stadium, coming up just 1 year after the LaMotta bout. Let's pick up the action in the third and final round.
Round three.
Robinson won his title in February 14, 1951 from Jake LaMotta, lost it to Randy Turpin in England in July, and regained it in a tremendous effort in September in New York City. There you see him double hooking and carrying those punches underneath into the body. At this point, many experts are saying that Graziano looked anything but bad in his boxing against Ray Robinson. And Ray goes down. It's an official knockdown. But before the fight began, the Illinois Boxing Commission ruled that a man would not have to stay down for the mandatory count of eight. Maybe the knockdown will infuriate Robinson. This has been his history in his great efforts in the ring. It took a lashing by Randy Turpin in their second fight to bring him back to a point where he smashed Turpin to the ground to take back the middleweight championship of the world. So Graziano has scored the first knockdown. And there goes his mouthpiece, and Graziano hits the canvas. Two, three, four, six, seven, eight, nine, 10. Ray Robinson retains the middleweight championship of the world. Graziano is still trying to kick some life into his legs and some spark into his numbing senses. A crowd of 23,785, which never sat in its expensive seats, witnessing one of the finest exchanges for the middleweight championship of the world, paying over $252,000. Graziano walking dejectedly to his corner and understandably sad. This was the moment he had asked for, but certainly not the conclusion he had anticipated.
That was Sugar Ray at his best, coming back and taking care of business. Gil, an awful lot of hype about some pretty impressive boxers today, but can anyone in the fight game today compare to Sugar Ray?
There was only one Sugar Ray Robinson. Had that special electricity about him. There's never been anyone like him before or since.
All right, Gil, thank you very much. Coming up, some final thoughts on Sugar Ray Robinson after this word from your local station. Sugar Ray considered himself a tough negotiator and a shrewd businessman. That's his restaurant behind the Pink Caddy on 124th Street and 7th Avenue in Harlem. Today, an apartment house has replaced it. Across the way, the Hotel Teresa, by which his motorcade would speed, is now an office building. But this past June, New York City named the intersection after him. And soon, a cornerstone will be placed here. Suffering from Alzheimer's disease, Sugar Ray Robinson, age 67, died this past April. At his funeral, the fight crowd joined his fans and heard the Reverend Jesse Jackson eulogize him.
Whenever he fought, the world had a way of standing still. The sin of the ring belonged to him.
Now, it's been 50 years since Sugar Ray first caught our eye by winning the Golden Gloves. Since then, scores of heroes have come and gone. But Sugar Ray appreciated that, and in fact, one of his favorite songs was Everything Must Change.
Everything must change. Nothing stays the same. No, no. Everyone must change. Nothing stays the same. The young become the old. Mysteries do unfold. 'Cause that's the way of time. No nothing and no one goes unchanged. There are not many things in life you can be sure of, except rain comes from the clouds and sun lights up the sky. And hummingbirds do fly. Winter turns to spring. Wounded heart will heal. Yes, it will. But never much too soon. Everything must change. The young become the old. Mysteries do unfold.
Words, thank you, are comparatively small for the way that I feel right now, but what else could you say on an occasion like this? Thank you.